This SciShow video is supported by Linode. You can get a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account at linode.com/scishow. Thanks to state-of-the-art telescopes like the James Webb, we can look so deep into time and space that we can see some of the very first galaxies and hunt for the very first stars. And other telescopes can take us even further back in time, to a point 380,000 years after the universe was born, when light first began to shine through space. For a universe that's roughly 13.8 billion years old, that's a pretty solid baby picture. But for scientists, it's not good enough. They want to study just slivers of a second after the universe was born, when everything we know was packed into an area the size of a marble. Space was opaque, and subatomic particles like protons and neutrons were a thing of the future. The problem is, because the universe was opaque back then, we will never see this moment in time. But we might be able to observe it anyway, using a completely different kind of signal. Gravitational waves. Astronomers think that this moment in time created wrinkles in the fabric of space. And if it did, those wrinkles are still out there. If we managed to find them, it would clarify how the universe came to be, and exactly what happened in the fractions of a second that defined the entire course of the universe. For nearly a century, gravitational waves were purely hypothetical. Einstein published his theory of general relativity in 1915, and a completely mind-bending idea soon popped out of the math. The math showed that any object with mass that was accelerating through space-time would warp space-time, and that warping would ripple out into the greater universe at the speed of light. As space-time squeezed and stretched, the distances between objects would change. Of course, we do not see the world around us warp every time a truck passes by or a plane takes off. Gravitational waves are weak. But according to general relativity, the more massive an object and the faster it is moving, the stronger its gravitational waves will be. So scientists eventually started to think that gravitational waves from the most extreme events in the universe might just be detectable if you could build a machine capable of measuring changes smaller than a proton. Enter LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. Actually, it is a pair of observatories that work together. One's in Washington State and the other is in Louisiana. Each one has two arms that are 4 kilometers long and meet to form an L shape. And they are shaped that way because when a gravitational wave passes through space, that space will stretch in one direction and squeeze in the perpendicular direction. So if a gravitational wave were to ripple through the observatory, one arm would get longer, while the other one would get shorter. In 2015, almost exactly 100 years after Einstein's theory of general relativity dropped, LIGO picked up a brief little chirp made by the gravitational waves of two merging black holes, each roughly 30 times the mass of our sun. The discovery was not only a major confirmation of general relativity, it also opened up a whole new way of exploring the universe, using gravity as a probe instead of light. And once it was clear that any kind of gravitational wave was definitely real and definitely detectable, the idea of finding primordial gravitational waves, the ones created just after the dawn of reality as we know it, didn't sound that far-fetched. But if any of these primordial waves were out there, we could not rely on LIGO to pick them up. Just like human ears can only pick up sound waves within a certain frequency range, LIGO can't detect all gravitational waves. It's limited to frequencies between roughly 10 and 10,000 peaks per second. And the objects that churn out those frequencies are objects like your garden variety black hole or neutron star, spiraling ever closer together until they smush. Primordial gravitational waves, on the other hand, are an entirely different beast. These would have been made during or right after a hypothetical period known as inflation that happened just after the birth of the universe. During inflation, the observable universe swelled exponentially, going from a subatomic speck to about the size of a marble. It was all over in a fraction of a second, like this many seconds. But during this flash of expansion, our universe was dominated by constant, subatomically small fluctuations in energy that warped space-time just like an object with mass does today. And it's impossible for our Earthling brains to truly envision this baby universe, so for now, let's just imagine a lake. Plus, a bunch of raindrops falling down onto that lake, creating ripples in the smooth surface. according to our current knowledge of how physics works, as space-time writhed in this early universe, gravitational waves rippled outward. And as the universe doubled in size many times over during this split second, those hypothetical ripples turned into longer waves. So in our metaphor, we would also need our lake to be growing, but that's okay. It's all inside of our minds. We could totally make that happen. Imagine the lake growing. Currently, cosmologists don't know exactly how inflation played out. They're not even 100% sure it happened. And that's not too surprising, since we've never been able to observe that far back in time. There could be multiple sources of these inflation-era gravitational waves. Some may have even been generated by inflation ending. But no matter how this split second of cosmic history went down, it was likely a time when space was getting stretched and contorted in extreme ways. And this was bound to produce gravitational waves. Then, as our tiny baby universe swelled to its current size, those waves stretched out. What started as microscopic ripples would be light years long now. And that's why finding these ancient waves is not a job for LIGO. Each one is billions of times longer. The frequencies are billions of times lower than the waves LIGO can detect. In fact, there is no way to build a LIGO-type detector on Earth that is long enough to pick up primordial gravitational waves. The arms would need to stretch beyond Earth itself. Fortunately, astronomers have found a way to do just that. It's called a pulsar timing array. A pulsar is a spinning neutron star that shoots electromagnetic radiation from its poles. And from Earth's vantage point, that spinning makes the radiation appear to flash. So basically, pulsars are like cosmic lighthouses. And some of these lighthouses are flashing so steadily, the pulsars are spinning at such a precise speed, that their signals run like clockwork. Or they do until something disturbs the space between them and us. And sometimes, that something is a gravitational wave. Just like when a gravitational wave rolls through the Earth and ever so slightly stretches and compresses the arms of LIGO, it can do the same thing to interstellar space. It changes the distance that light travels from a pulsar to the Earth, and that tweaks the arrival time. A flash either arrives too soon or too late. Now, gravitational waves aren't the only thing that can mess with a pulsar's timing, so astronomers have to account for a lot of other possibilities before declaring that a gravitational wave is behind any wonky signal. But in principle, an array of extremely regular pulsars can work a lot like LIGO, just with a bunch more arms and blown up to an interstellar scale. And this is how astronomers finally discovered evidence of low-frequency gravitational waves in 2023. As part of a collaboration called NanoGrav, researchers around the world compiled 15 years of data from 67 pulsars. And what they found was not one isolated wave rolling through, like what LIGO spots. Instead, the signal was sort of a background noise, a pattern of irregularities coming from all directions that suggests all of space-time is subtly and slowly quivering. But unfortunately, the NanoGrav team doesn't know what's creating this gravitational wave background. It's like if you had a bunch of rowboats and swimmers and gusts of wind creating waves in a lake, and you wanted to figure out which wave came from which source, but you could only look at the water and not the things on the water. And when a bunch of waves interfere with each other, it's not easy to tease them apart. The leading hypothesis is that these low-frequency waves are coming from supermassive black holes at the centers of merging galaxies. Unlike the smaller black holes that LIGO detects, these behemoths spend millions of years slowly spiraling around each other before they finally collide. Based on computer simulations, spiraling supermassive black holes could produce the signal that the NanoGrav team observed. And if a supermassive black hole merger is what caused these waves, it would be the first direct evidence of such an event ever happening. But for now, there are still a few other possibilities on the table. One of them is that these gravitational waves, or at least some of them, are primordial, created in the first second of the universe's existence. Scientists on the NanoGrav team also simulated what a low-frequency gravitational wave background would look like if it was created by inflation, and those simulations reproduced what the researchers observed. As their pulsar timing array provides more data, the NanoGrav team hopes they'll be able to pin down the true origin of this signal. Something that'll really help is figuring out how to tease apart different sources of gravitational waves based on the frequencies they generate. Going back to the lake analogy, you can imagine that waves from a passing boat are going to look different from waves stirred up by the wind or by a person doing a belly flop. So if scientists can figure out the typical profile of a gravitational wave produced by a supermassive black hole merger, they will be able to filter out those signals and just look for the primordial waves. If they ever find them, we'd have some of the strongest evidence yet that inflation really did happen. And hopefully the details of those primordial waves would teach us what exactly went down back then. By studying a signal that's basically as old as the known universe, we'd finally be able to confirm whether or not some fundamental laws of physics work the way theoretical physicists think they do. Which would be a lot better than looking at a picture from when the universe was 380,000 years old and trying to extrapolate backward. But first, we need more data. Astronomers need to find more pulsars that are reliable enough to add to NanoGrav's array, and watch the array for even longer to see if meaningful patterns emerge. Humanity will have to wait a while before anyone announces they've definitely detected a primordial gravitational wave. But we might not have to wait as long as you might think, because NanoGrav isn't the only collaboration doing this work. Teams in China and Australia are also monitoring their own pulsar timing arrays, and all of these teams are working to combine their data to try and get an even clearer picture. And even though it's using gravity instead of light to take that picture, making it a little harder to print out and put on the wall, I am ready to add an even older baby picture to the universe's photo album. Thank you to Linode for supporting this and so many other SciShow videos. Linode is a cloud computing company from Akamai that keeps some of the best stuff on the internet running with data centers across the world. Like, if you're part of a giant business, Linode can handle your storage needs. With a petabyte of object storage, even the big dogs are covered. And Linode is constantly improving. Just this year, they've reduced latency, increased storage, and added global servers to their already fast, vast, and far-reaching service. But just because Linode works great for large businesses doesn't mean your company has to be a giant international corporation to get the most out of Linode. You can scale your services and corresponding payments to only what you need. And you can get going by clicking the link in the description down below, or heading to linode.com/scishow for a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account. Thanks for watching, and thanks for learning with us here at SciShow.